So good morning all of you. Today we have Mr. Shyam Singh, Indian Railway Traffic Service Officer of 2016 batch. Before getting selected as IRTS, he has a vast experience of serving in Madhya Pradesh State Civil Service from 2008 till 2017. He has served as project officer in the Women and Child Development Department of MP State, as Chief Executive Officer of Janapada Panchayat and Rural Development Department of the State of Madhya Pradesh. He has held portfolios of implementing very ambitious scheme MNREGA, Housing Scheme, Swach Bharat Mission. Today, we will be discussing the ethics portion of General Studies Paper 4, UPSC Civil Services Mains Exam 2018. Since ethics is one of the most essential component of administration and therefore highly driven by field experience and real life case studies, which is one of the demand of the examination as put forth in paper number 4 of GS Mains. So let me invite him to take the platform to discuss the paper for the benefit of the students. Thank you.
Hello friends, so today we discuss GS paper 4, Ethics, Integrity and Aptitude of UPSC examination, Civil Services Mains examination 2018. So one by one we will discuss all the questions. We will focus more on the slightly tougher questions, then we will take case studies. So we will emphasize more to difficult questions. So I am taking one by one all the questions. So, first question is, state the three basic values universal in nature in the context of civil services and bring out their importance. So, first of all, I will tell you one thing. The questions of UPSC are not as easy as they appear to be, because one question of UPSC comprises of various components, various aspects. So you have to identify those aspects. Here question says three basic values. And universal. So here you have to give those values which are universal in the context of civil services. Civil services as well as importance of those values. So this is very simple question. Here you have to put three basic values which are universal. It means these values are acceptable in each and every countries of the world in context of civil services. So these values are, first is integrity, second, dedication to work, and third is fearlessness. This is a very simple question, but here you have to understand that you will not discuss the values given by second ARC or given by other institutions or organizations, because you have to discuss the basic values, foundational values of civil services. So you can discuss these three values: integrity, dedication to work, fearlessness. This is very simple question, and you can see integrity, dedication to work, and fearlessness very easily. So I think these values are not required to be elaborated. You understand this? Integrity is about transparency, honesty. It is about what you think, what you say, what you do. So there must be perfect conformity between your words, your thoughts, and your actions. And thoughts of any civil servants are nothing but the thoughts of the government, basic concepts to establish a welfare state. So all the rules, regulations, circulars, conduct rules are the thoughts of a civil servant. And obviously, the words of the civil servant in terms of speech or in terms of giving instructions to their subordinate or in terms of written representation to their subordinates and superiors. So these should be based upon the thoughts, which are rules and regulation, conducts. So obviously, based on deontology, transparency, no corruption free actions. Integrity is very important because it deals with the honesty, transparency. That is why in APAR of a civil servant, annual performance appraisal report, it is also known as ACR in some states. In state civil services, ACR, it is known as ACR, annual confidential report. So in APAR and ACR, there is a column of integrity, Satyanishtha. If this column is commented as or quoted as doubtful, then it means the services of that civil servant is no more required. So it must be always beyond doubtful, beyond doubt. Okay, so dedication to work, you know, it is not required to discuss. So we will take second question. Distinguish between code of ethics and code of conducts with suitable examples. This is a good question. Distinguish between code of ethics and code of conducts. So first of all, we have to understand what is code of ethics and what is code of conduct. Then we will try to discriminate between these two things. First is code of ethics. Second, code of conducts. Code of ethics. Code of ethics are philosophical framework. Okay, it talks about the philosophy of administration, philosophy of business. Here, business may be a private business or a government governance or public administration. So, philosophy of a particular business or behavior or transaction is code of ethics. So, this is a philosophical framework for professionals. So, it talks about mission, vision and values. Okay, mission, vision and values. Code of ethics comprises of mission. It says what are the missions, what are the visions, and what are the values. So it does not give precise information or precise conduct rules. It just gives the outline, and according to those outlines, code of conducts are prepared. So this is the scientific basis or philosophical basis for code of conducts. So all the code of conducts are prepared in the light of code of ethics. So you can say this is the preamble or introduction of conduct rules. Okay, so in India we opted code of ethics recently. Previously we prepared code of conducts in 1964. There are different code of conducts for different services, for all India civil services, It is All India Civil Services Conduct Rule 1964. Similarly, for Central Civil Services, it is CCS Conduct Rule 1964. And Federal Civil Services or Public Services also opted different conduct rules for their states, like Madhya Pradesh Civil Services Conduct Rule 1966. Similarly, in Uttar Pradesh, conduct rules are there, and all these conduct rules are very similar to each other. They talk about the proper action of a civil servant, do's and don'ts. So what is conduct? Do's and don'ts. So these are very precise. These are not philosophical. These are factual. Very much factual. Okay. So conduct rules are based on deontology. Here we don't have enough scope to explain deontology, because deontology is a subject in itself, so it requires vast discussion. So this is based on deontology. On the other hand, code of ethics, these are philosophical, so that is why these are based on teleology. Teleology, it means code of conducts are means. These are means. These are instruments to achieve ends. Whereas code of ethics are based on ends. Okay. So, these ends will be achieved with the help of this code of conducts. So, these are means. So, these are based on deontology and these are based on teleology. You can understand code of ethics with the help of certain examples, like if we take example of medical professionals like doctors, surgeons. So they are driven by the code of conduct, which is known as Hippocratic Oath. Hippocratic Oath. Hippocratic Oath. Hippocratic Oath. Hippocrate, father of medicine, he gave a oath, hana, which is taken by each and every medical practitioner. So that is code of conduct for medical practitioner. This Hippocratic oath is more philosophical. It doesn't talk about do's and don'ts. Do's and don'ts are given by state, by different medico-legal laws, rules, regulations. So Hippocratic oath is code of ethics. Here medico-legal rules are given by code of conducts. What should be the conduct of a doctor or a private doctor, government doctors, hana? Recently Supreme Court advised that there is no required of an FIR or police case in the cases of accidents. So a doctor must provide initial treatment to the patients. आप लोग देखते भी होंगे एडवर्टीजमेंट में. सो दिस इज कोड ऑफ एथिक्स, दिस इज कोड ऑफ कंडक्ट. सिमिलरली इन सिविल सर्विसेज देयर आर कोड ऑफ एथिक्स लाइक मेंटेन डिवोशन टू ड्यूटी, मेंटेन एब्सोल्यूट इंटीग्रिटी, डू नथिंग विच इज अनबिकमिंग ऑफ ए सिविल सर्वेंट, योर एक्ट शुड नॉट बी लाइक दैट. That is unbecoming of a civil servant. Commit himself to and uphold the supremacy of the constitution and democratic values. So these are code of ethics we recently opted. And in code of conducts, there are different code of conducts, like taking part in politics and elections. So code of conduct ka example ho sakta hai, taking part in elections. So, Central Civil Services Conduct Rules or All India Civil Services Conduct Rules say that a bureaucrat or a civil servant must not take part in elections or any political activity. He should not involve in strikes. He should not use intoxications in the time of duty. So, these are different conduct rules. Conduct rules related to accept gifts, conduct rules. If you are going to accept any gift more than ₹25,000, then you have to intimate the government about those gifts. So these are the conduct rules. So we can say that code of ethics are general statements, and code of ethics are particular statement or specific. Particular statements, specific, these are very specific. Okay, so this was the question. So in this way you can give the answer. Second question is very good question. What is mean by public interest? What is mean by public interest? And what are the principles and procedures to be followed by the civil servants in public interest? So you have to give the procedures. While serving in public interest, so first you have to explain what is public service, public interest, sorry. Then procedure to implement, procedure to implement public interest. Okay, so there are two parts of this question, so you have to focus 50 to 60 words in explaining public interest, remaining rest of the 100 words in describing procedure to implement public interest. Okay, so there are two parts. So firstly we will see what is public interest. So to explain public interest is a difficult task. You cannot explain this easily. How? The public interest is a term for which there is no single precise definition. So how can you give the definition of public interest? So we will start explaining public interest right from the contract theory. Okay, so what is contract theory? Social contract theory. Social contract theory given by Hobbes, John Locke, Rawls, Rousseau. So the basic of contract theory is each and every action or decision of a member of a particular society is governed by the establishment of some common goods. So here common goods, theory of common goods are of vital importance because this is the central theme of any social contract theory. So every member of a society has some duties, he has some rights, and these duties and rights are regarding to achieve this common goods of a society, that particular society. So here public interest is the common good of that society. If we talk about the example of Indian administration, so here there are certain common goods which have to be achieved. So public servants are the instrumental to achieve these common goods. So these common goods are the public interest here, common goods. So here public service and public services, there are two terms, public servant and public services, both are different. Okay, public service is about different type of services like administrative services, legal services, welfare services, rural development services, these are public service. Okay, and public services are related to public interest. Okay, so this is public interest. So it means there is no individual interest of a civil servant. All the interests are public interest. Okay, so each and every action of a civil servant must be following the public interest of common people. So your decision, whether those are your discretionary powers or you are based on deontology, clear cut rules and regulations, the ends must be public interest. Okay, so we can define this public interest in this term. So public interest also comprises of your individual interests. Okay, these individual interests must be reasonable interests. A civil servant cannot have an interest like I have to be a billionaire. See, his interest is about his salary, his perks, his other luxuries, whatever. Okay, not more than that. So this comprises of common interest as well as individual interest which are legal. Okay, so this is public interest, and every civil servant has duty, and actually he was given duty to serve the public because we want to serve the public welfare state, to establish a welfare state. Okay, so if we take an example of public interest, you have heard about compulsory retirement. Compulsory retirement. Okay. So there is a rules, there is a rule and regulations about compulsory retirement. If after 15 and 25 years of services in Central Civil Services and All India Civil Services, and similar rules are there in Federal Civil Services, the services of all public servants are scrutinized under the continuity of his performance. If his performance is degrading continuously, then his service is no more required because he is not serving the public interest. So in public interest he must be compulsorily retired because he is like deadwood. Is no more required. Is not serving the public interest. So this can be an example of public interest. Now, next part of this is procedure to implement public interest. So there are four dimensions of public interest. First is inputs. Second, output. Third, procedure, process. So now, second part of this question is about process or procedure. So what procedures should be adopted? First is impartiality. While serving the public interest, you must be impartial. It includes the absence of discrimination or acting apolitically. In performance of official functions. Okay, so it means that the actions of a civil servant must be impartial. He should not be influenced by any political theory, political philosophy, or any politicians, views of any politicians. Okay, he can have some personal views, but these views will be taken into consideration while casting the votes, individual vote. He will not take into consideration about the political views while serving as a civil servant. Okay, so he must serve apolitically, impartially. Second, fairness. Whenever a public servant has to exercise his discretionary power, okay, so generally while exercising a discretionary power, the rules and regulations, clear cut rules and regulations are absent, you don't have any precise guidelines, then there is enough possibility of unfairness. So a public servant, to establish public interest, fairness in his action, in exercise of discretionary powers, including procedural fairness. Here, procedural fairness. Fairness regarding procedure, making files, documentation, all these things should be fair so that implementation of RTI can be determined. Okay, so foolproof documentation is required. Third is reasonableness. What is reasonableness? Value for money. A civil servant holds vast public money. Okay, and this money should be spent in public interest, and a civil servant must utilize the public money as his personal money. Okay, so he has to follow reasonableness, maximum services in minimum public expenditure, because money is pertaining to public. That money comes from taxes, that is public money. So public pay taxes for public interest, different common goods. So there must be reasonableness. Okay, example, अगर आपको लैपटॉप लेना है तो ये नहीं कि आप 1 लाख का लैपटॉप खरीद रहे हैं, क्योंकि उससे आपको बहुत सारी स्कीम्स को इम्प्लीमेंट करना है ना. यू मस्ट बी रीजनेबल वाइल परचेजिंग. सो देर आर डिफरेंट परचेज रूल्स, स्टोर एंड परचेज रूल्स, सो यू हैव टू फॉलो दोज रूल्स. नेक्स्ट फोर्थ, कॉन्फिडेंशियलिटी. यस, दिस इज ऑल्सो इंपॉर्टेंट in public interest. A public servant must not reveal the information of vital importance. Okay, like he should keep the faith of his ministers intact, hai na. To koi bhi scheme bana rahe hain, master plan bana rahe hain, he should not reveal the essentials of those master plans, otherwise that those information can be misused by various players. Okay, outsiders, and they sometimes they can work as a pressure group also. Okay, so this is confidentiality. Next is proper accountability and transparency. Accountability is a vast subject in itself, we will discuss it later. There is a question in this paper about accountability, we will discuss it. Proper accountability, making of appropriate record, acceptance of proper scrutiny, public access to information, RTI, public access to information, RTI. So in this way, you can give a complete answer of this question. Okay. Now we will discuss our next question. Next question is, the Right to Information Act is not all about citizens' empowerment alone. It essentially redefines the concept of accountability discussed. Okay, so there are two parts in this question. First is, RTI is not empowering citizens alone, first part. And second part is, it is redefining accountability. Okay, so you have to divide this question under two parts. RTI is not empowering citizens alone. So first you will discuss this part, then you will discuss this part and make a connectivity between these two statements finally. So in this way you will conclude your answer. Okay, so there are two parts. First is, RTI is not empowering citizens. So what is RTI? How will you start this question? What is RTI? So RTI is, we will start it from right to speech under Article 19(1)(a). Okay, so this is right to speech of right to speech of citizens as well as public offices. Okay, this is not only about the right of speech of citizen. Firstly, it is about right to speech of public offices, because there are certain acts like official secret acts. These secret acts and other acts are muzzling the different public offices. These acts apply different restrictions to reveal the informations of a public offices. Used to, not now. After RTI, right to speech has become essential right of a public officer. It means a public office has right to disclose its documents before the public. Okay, it can disclose its expenditures, it can disclose its various schemes, criteria, different criteria of beneficiaries. Okay, so this is right to speech of a public office as well as citizens. How this is right to speech for a citizen? RTI makes informed citizenry. RTI makes informed citizenry. Now after RTI, these citizens are well informed. Once they are informed with different essential characteristics or different services which are given by a public office, so these citizens can speak about their rights, they can speak about their duties. Okay, so in this way RTI has determined information, right to speech of public officers and citizens. So this is not empowering citizens alone. We will see this after redefining accountability. ठीक है, यहाँ तो आप समझ चुके हैं कि ये केवल citizens को नहीं empower कर रहा, this is also empowering the public offices. Okay, next is redefining accountability. What is accountability? So first of all, we have to explain accountability. What is accountability? Accountability is a nearer term to responsibility, but it is different from responsibility. Responsibility has a broader connotation, and accountability is a subset of responsibility. Okay, this is a part of responsibility. Responsibility is a wider term. Okay, so you can understand accountability as answerability. Accountability makes a civil servant answerable to different people. These people may be his superior, these people may be common citizens, these people may be some enforcement agencies. Okay, he has to give answer to his superior for his conducts, he has to give answer to his beneficiaries, he also has to give answer to different enforcement agencies like CAG, Auditor General. Okay, there is provisions of annual audits under different auditors like local fund audit, okay, AG audit, concurrent audit, CA audit. So these type of audits are there. So these audits are what these audits are doing. Actually, they are making answerable to a public servant, because he is spending public money, so he has to give answer where and in what way he has spent the money. Okay, so here you have to understand the dimensions of accountability. First of all, you have to understand dimensions of accountability, different dimensions. First is vertical accountability. Okay, second, horizontal accountability, and third is diagonal accountability. So there are three types of accountability. First is vertical accountability. As the name suggests, vertical accountability is answerability in hierarchical manner. Hierarchical manner means these are superiors, different superiors. So there is well defined hierarchy in government administration as well as in private administration, but in our case we will talk about government organizations. So if this is a public servant of operating corps, any public servant, you can say that this person is tehsildar or SDM, so he is accountable to district collector, okay, because district collector is immediate superior of this public officer. Okay, then collector is answerable to divisional commissioner. And divisional commissioner is accountable to principal secretary, and this principal secretary is accountable to chief secretary and his minister. Okay, so in this way this vertical accountability is implemented. Okay, so here this is vertical accountability. So what will this do? Vertical accountability kya karega? We will discuss it in while discussing the second statement of our question. Okay, so you just understand what is vertical accountability. Here you just understand it. Second is horizontal accountability. So horizontal accountability is about different enforcement agencies which time to time scrutinizes the functions of different public offices. So these enforcement agencies monitors the actions of this public office. Okay, so these enforcement agencies may be CAG with the help of audits, Lokayukt is also an enforcement agency. Next, EOW, Economic Offence Wing. So there are several enforcement agencies. These agencies decides horizontal accountability because this public office has to reply, has to give answer to these enforcement agencies once these enforcement agency ask questions, hana? So they have to give explanation, proper explanation. So this is horizontal accountability. Third is diagonal accountability. This is diagonal. This is a public servant. He is answerable to his superior. But for good governance, it is required the participation of common people to implement a scheme. If we talk about Swach Bharat Mission, you cannot implement Swach Bharat Mission your own. A public servant alone cannot implement Swach Bharat Mission, hana? So even if we talk about MNREGA scheme, you cannot implement MNREGA alone, hana? It requires wider political support as well as public supports. Okay, so there are different schemes where citizens' support is required for successful implementation, for efficient governance, hassle-free implementation. Okay, and if you want that public should contribute, then you have to be answerable to public. Okay, so here this answerability to public is diagonal accountability. You can also give the example of diagonal accountability as social audit. Okay, this can be an example of diagonal accountability. Participation of public in any while organizing any mela or fair, so that the problem of law and order can be resolved. Okay, without public participation you cannot successfully implement law and order. So this is diagonal accountability. So now our question is redefining. It is RTI is redefining accountability. So we have to give answer in the light of RTI. It is redefining these accountabilities. Kaise redefine kar rahi hai RTI? Actually RTI, what is the use of RTI? Use of RTI is to establish informed citizenry. Okay, so we can understand that RTI is redefining accountability as professional accountability. Professional accountability. Second, political accountability. For professional accountability, political accountability, administrative accountability, administrative accountability. And democratic accountability. Political accountability. What is political accountability? What is political accountability? Political accountability is horizontal accountability. Why it is horizontal accountability? Because public is scrutinizing the actions of politicians, okay, public offices. So here political accountability, here with the help of RTI, common citizens understand the functioning of public office. They can analyze the efficient governance, efficiency of governance, efficiency of public administration. On the basis of the governance, quality of administration, they will come to know who to vote. Tab to unhe pata chalega ki now, for again, us government ko lekar aana hai ki nahi. Okay, to information jab tak nahi hogi, ki kitna paisa kharch kar diya, karna kitna tha, usse assets kitne create hue, what is the sustainability of that program's output. So output is not sustainable, then they will not cast their vote in favor of incumbent government. Okay, so here this is making political accountability with the help of RTI. With the help of RTI, citizens come to know who to vote. Second is administrative accountability. Administrative accountability, with the help of RTI, different public servants come to know that in what manner his superior has commented on their ACR or APAR. Okay, so there is a provision to communicate the adverse entries in the ACR. If the government does not communicate, or communication is not occurred because of some reasons, then that government servant will not come to understand that my performance is degrading or I am performing well. So here with the help of RTI, he can come to know the different entries in his ACR. Okay, so with the help of RTI, different public servants secured their privileges in terms of his career, है ना? तो RTI में adverse entries से कई बार career खराब हो जाता है, है ना? With the help of RTI, they come to know and they can explain, give explanation that my performance was not that worst. Okay, so he can put his views, put his representation before the government. Okay, so in this manner, administrative accountability is redefining. Democratic accountability. Next is democratic accountability. What is democratic accountability? This is diagonal accountability, democratic accountability. Okay, greater participation of people, civic participation in decision making. Now, if our citizenry is not well informed, how can our citizenry efficiently participate in government schemes? Hana? First of all, they should know what are the programs, what are the essentials of that program, what are the manners, what are different rules and regulations. So once they come to know different aspects of a program, with the help of RTI, democratic contribution will be more efficient. Okay, so in this manner you can give this answer. So RTI increases the know-how and better performance of public administration. Okay, now our next question is, what is conflict of interest? What is conflict of interest? Illustrate with the examples. The difference between the actual and potential conflict of interest. So again, this question has two parts. What is conflict of interest? And second part is actual and potential conflict of interest. Actual and potential conflict of interest. So first, conflict of interest. What is conflict of interest? It means there are several interests. There are several interests. And you have to find out, if you are a civil servant, you have to find out what is the proper interest, what is the actual interest. So, interest of a civil servant or a public servant lies in the interest of public interest. Civil servant ka koi interest to hota nahi hai. His interest is public interest. As pointed out by Aristotle, Plato, Plato says, while defining four cardinal virtues, what Plato says? Plato says the ruling class, kings or queens, they should not maintain any private property. They should use government properties. They should refrain from accumulation of wealth. इसलिए ये प्रोविजन किए गए हैं कि कलेक्टर को बंगला क्यों दिया जाता है, गवर्नमेंट सर्वेंट्स को क्यों बंगले दिए जाते हैं, एकोमोडेशन क्यों प्रोवाइड किए जाते हैं. दे आर प्रोवाइडेड व्हीकल्स. व्हाई? सो दैट देयर इज नो नीड टू एक्युमुलेट वेल्थ फॉर पर्सनल सर्विस, पर्सनल लग्जरी. ओके, सो इसलिए दिए जाते हैं. तो पब्लिक का इंटरेस्ट सिविल सर्वेंट का इंटरेस्ट है. ओके, व्हेन दिस इंटरेस्ट transform into personal interest, then there is a situation of conflict. Conflicting situation arises. So this is conflict of interest. So this conflict of interest may be of two types. First is personal conflict of interest, and second is organizational conflict of interest. Organizational conflict of interest. First is personal conflict of interest. What is personal conflict of interest? When personal interests are arising and they are in conflicting situation with the public interest, like a civil servant wants to utilize the public wealth for his luxuries, for his personal use, in his personal use. So here public interest, there will be personal conflict of interest. Okay, so a civil servant must not utilize public fund for his own sake. Okay, this is public personal organizational conflict of interest. Some people are associated with different associations, like associations of civil servants, IAS association, IPS association. Similarly, your employer, that is an organization. So your function should be according to public interest, not according to serve your organization's interest. Okay, while you are serving in public sector, your interest must be public interest. So yahan par organization interest conflict ki agar hum baat kare, to yahan par example ke taur par ye personal conflict to kya hoga, pecuniary relationship, financial relationship. Okay, utilization of public fund, पर्सनल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट और रिलेटिव्स के जो इंटरेस्ट हो सकते हैं इन योर ज्यूरिडिक्शन, दे विल क्रिएट पर्सनल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट में कौन से इंटरेस्ट होंगे, वी कैन गिव एग्जाम्पल ऑफ लेटरल एंट्रीज. लेटरल एंट्रीज, ओके, दीज लेटरल एंट्रेंस आर दीज लेटरल एंट्रीज आर बिलोंगिंग फ्रॉम डिफरेंट प्राइवेट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. वंस दे विल कम, वंस दे कम इन द पब्लिक ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, देयर माइट बी अ केस दैट दे विल मेक एडवाइसेज, दे विल मेक पॉलिसीज फॉर द एडवांटेज ऑफ देयर पेरेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. इट माइट बी अ केस, सो दिस शुड बी टेकन इन टू कंसिडरेशन. ओके, सो दिस इज ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. सो अवर क्वेश्चन वॉज एक्चुअल एंड पोटेंशियल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. एक्चुअल एंड पोटेंशियल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट, एक्चुअल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट, एक्चुअल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट इज ऑल्सो नॉन एज एपरेंट, एपरेंट, ओके, विच इज एविडेंट. सेकेंड पोटेंशियल. सो एक्चुअल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट आर दोज कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट विच आर सीन frequently and there is sufficient possibilities of happening these conflict of interest, because in past we have seen different examples and every time people serve this actual their interest. Example, actual conflict of interest ka example kya le sakte hain, जब हमेशा ऐसा रहा हो कि लोगों ने अपने इंटरेस्ट के लिए काम किया हो, दैट इज एक्चुअल कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. क्या एग्जांपल दे सकते हैं? इंक्रीज इन सैलरी एंड अलाउंसेस, बाय द पार्लियामेंटेरियंस. साउंड वोट से अपने अलाउंसेस को बढ़ा लेते हैं, हमेशा कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट होता है क्योंकि उनको खुद अपनी सैलरी बढ़ाना है. ओके, एंड इन टर्म्स ऑफ सैलरी दे आर व्हाट दे विल यूटिलाइज द पब्लिक मनी, दे विल यूज पब्लिक मनी, दैट मनी लाइज विद पब्लिक. ओके, एंड हियर दिस पार्लियामेंटेरियन हैज पावर टू इंक्रीज देयर सैलरीज एंड अलाउंसेस, सो देयर आर कॉन्फ्लिक्ट इन इंटरेस्ट, कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. So they always serve their interest. Okay, potential conflict of interest. Potential means there is some potency, there is sufficient potential to misuse powers or discretions. Okay, so whenever we talk about discretionary powers, there is always possibility of potential conflict of interest. Okay, you can make some discretion according to your interest. Okay, so here you can give example of lateral entries, hana, this has some potential to misuse the status or position. Next, actual conflict of interest. Can you create some check and balance in actual conflict of interest? There is no provision, generally no check and balance. That is why this is in frequent action, because there is no check and balance. Finally, you have to reach a state where a superior authority is making rules and regulation while explaining the sovereign in terms of social contract theory. It is said that sovereign must be controlled by some laws, rules and regulations, but these rules and regulations are always absent. So sovereign autocratic ho jate hain, despotic ho jate hain. Theek hai, to yahan no check and balance, here sufficient check and balance. You can create different check and balance like conduct rules. Conduct rules, check and balance and precautionary measures. Okay, precautionary measures. Conduct rules में बहुत सारे precautionary measures हम लेते हैं, do's and don'ts to check potential conflict of interest. Next, actual conflict of interest are based on past experiences, present experiences and future experiences. It pertains to past, present and future, whereas potential conflict of interest is pertaining to future. We are just making conjectures that in future this organization or this people can misuse his discretionary power, so it is related to future, so it is predictive. So in this way you can give answer of this question. There are two parts, okay, conflict of interest and discriminate actual and potential conflict of interest. Now next question is, in looking for people to hire you look for three qualities: integrity, intelligence and energy. And if they do not have the first, the other two will kill you. The other two will kill you. It means this question says, while hiring employees you see three qualities in them. First is integrity, second intelligence, and third is energy. And question says, if this first integrity is absent, this intelligence and energy will be misused, because it is saying that it can kill you. Kill you to whom? Employer. Employer. It means it can be detrimental to the employer or an organization where this type of people are working, employing. Okay, so we have to explain this. This is the statement of Warren Buffett. It doesn't matter who is giving the statement. What do you understand by this statement in the present day scenario? Okay, so here you have to explain integrity, intelligence and energy. Okay, what is integrity? What is integrity? Transparency, honesty. Okay, so we can describe integrity as perfect conformity. Perfect conformity in what? Your thoughts, your words and your actions. So the thoughts of an employee must be the thoughts of the organization. So what is the principles of organization, those principles must be followed by this employee. Okay, so thoughts kya hai, organization ke jo thoughts hai, organizational values. Okay, his words must be based on these values, and his actions, this action should also be the objectives of employer. ने जिस काम के लिए आपको हायर किया है उस ऑब्जेक्ट को फुलफिल करना ही आपका एक्शन होना चाहिए. ओके, सो देयर मस्ट बी परफेक्ट कन्फॉर्मिटी. इफ दैट एम्प्लॉय विल नॉट थिंक इन दिस मैनर, इन अ प्रॉपर मैनर, सो एंड इट मे बी दैट हिज वर्ड्स आर डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, देन इट विल बी डेट्रीमेंटल ऑब्वियसली. सो इंटीग्रिटी मस्ट बी इंटैक्ट, इसलिए कहते हैं कि निष्ठा खंडित नहीं होना चाहिए, इट मस्ट बी इंटैक्ट. ओके, सो वॉट अबाउट इंटेलिजेंस एंड एनर्जी? वॉट इज इंटेलिजेंस? इंटेलिजेंस पर्टेंस टू स्किल. ओके, लर्निंग पावर. सो हियर इंटेलिजेंस, इफ ही हैज sufficient amount of intelligence, more intelligent he is, he has more energy, then and integrity is not intact, so he will just going to misuse his intelligence and energy. So kaise misuse karega wo intelligence and energy ka? His words will be manipulative because he is intelligent, so he will use manipulative words. Okay, jaisa ki sophists kehte hain, hai na, sophists philosophers, they talk about logos, rhetorical persuasion, logos, rhetorical persuasion. If he is intelligent, he will be more cunning, he will be more shrewd, hai na, he will be more impressive, so he can dupe the organizations, he can misuse the values of your organizations. Okay, energy, if energy is not properly channelized, this would be more harmful. So in present scenario, what can be the examples? First example, misuse of intelligence because integrity is not intact. Kya ho sakta hai example? Ketan Mehta, Ketan, aap example, bahut sare example na dekhe, ye dekh sakte hain corporate frauds. Okay, इंटीग्रिटी इंटैक्ट नहीं थी कॉर्पोरेट फ्रॉड से. अभी नीरव मोदी वाला जो मामला है उसे हम देख सकते हैं, है ना. तो यहाँ पे बैंकर्स की इंटीग्रिटी इंटैक्ट नहीं थी, तो उन्होंने इंटेलिजेंस का और अपने पावर का मिसयूज किया. नेक्स्ट एग्जांपल क्या देख सकते हैं? एटम बॉम्ब, न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी, मिसयूज ऑफ न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी बिकॉज the philosophy of nuclear power was to serve the mankind. Okay, we want to create some different sources of energy. Okay, so this energy was misused. Okay, so because integrity was not intact, intelligence was misused, and here also intelligence misused. So in this way you can give the answer of this question. Next question is, yes, next question is, in doing a good thing everything is permitted which is not prohibited expressly or by clear implication. Examine the statement with suitable examples in the context of a public servant discharging his or her duty. In doing a good thing, everything is permitted, okay, which is not prohibited expressly or by clear implication. This is the statement. So what this statement says, this statement pertains to emphasizing the ends. It is saying that end result is important. Okay, while you don't have clear cut instructions, it means are vague, hana, proper means are not available, then you will focus on ends. Okay, so you have to use your discretionary powers. Examine the statement with suitable examples in the context of a public servant discharging his or her duties. So there are different scenarios, different circumstances where a civil servant has to use his discretionary power in the absence of proper rules and regulations. So how his action should be, it should be based upon ends. Okay, to agar hum koi example le lein is tarah ka, providing arms license, okay, weapon ka license ke liye, there is no rules and regulations. Okay, here discretionary power of a district collector is important. So how will he decide who to give arm license? How will he decide? So he will decide on the basis of means. So means, on the basis of ends. Okay, so ends ke basis pe kaise decide karega? Okay, use of arms will be useful or not, okay, for that person. That person can handle arms properly or not, otherwise he will misuse it, okay, he will commit suicide finally, okay. This is the case. In most of the cases, arms are misused, they are not used in protection, okay. So ends yahan pe important hai, so it means it is teleological. It is based on teleology. Hana? He has to focus on ends. So which type of teleology? Teleology has utilitarian principle, utilitarianism. Teleology is based on consequentialism. Okay? So, which type of utilitarianism he will use? In the absence of proper means and to achieve proper ends. Actually, dekhiye, nobody knows the actual ends. Okay? Nobody knows the final consequences. Every circumstances, every decision are taken on the basis of prima facie consequences. Okay? You do not know the actual consequences. Like, if I am saving a person who is drowning in a river, okay, I saved his life, but after 10 years I will come to know, if I come to know after 10 years that person was Hitler and now he is responsible for mass level bloodshed, so our utility went in vain. Okay, so here foreseeable consequences and foreseeable consequences and actual consequences. So you cannot decide the consequences in different cases. So you must decide taking into consideration foreseeable consequences and actual consequences as more as you can understand. Means utilitarian principle kya kehta hai? What is utilitarian principle? Here you can use rule utilitarianism rather than act utilitarianism. What is rule utilitarianism? Use those rules and regulations which increase the set of rules and providing maximum benefit. Okay, here maximum benefit must be reasonable benefit, which should be well accepted, okay, which is serving a common good. So that is rule utilitarianism. Ab iska example ke taur par hum kya de sakte hain? Arm license ki agar hum baat kare to arm license kisko dena hai, kaise denge? It also depends upon attitude. So you have to put this aspect, attitude, emotional component. Second is affective, we kehte hain, cognitive component. Third, behavioral component. Okay, so on the basis of your emotional and cognitive component, emotional intelligence, you should decide the ends. And when you don't have very clear cut norms, means, then you will use Kantian theory of deontology. यहां आपको ये बतानी पड़ेगी, जहां कांट डियोंटोलॉजी प्रिंसिपल बताते हैं एंड कांट theory of deontology is known as categorical imperatives. Categorical imperatives. Okay, here categorical is about clear, distinct. Imperatives, commandments, orders. Okay. So when you are in a state of absence of proper means, then you will use categorical imperatives given by Kant. So Kant says, act only according to that maxim whereby you can at the same time act only according to that maxim whereby you can at the same time will desire that it should become a universal law without contradiction. Okay, so whatever your actions are, those actions must be well accepted. Those actions must be as universal law. Okay, so your action must be universally accepted. Second, act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own person or in the person of any other. Okay, so your action should not be biased. It should not be influenced by your near and dear one. Your actions should be neutral actions. Okay, so act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own, you treat humanity whether in your own person or in the person of any other, never merely as means to an end, never merely as a means to an end, but always at the same time as an ends. Okay, so Kant says that means are not always important. Means are important, but you have to take into consideration ends. Okay, so these means always proceed to some proper ends. Okay, third is, therefore every rational being must so act as if he were through his maxim always a legislative member in the universal legislator, universal kingdom of ends. Okay, so whenever you will take any decision, you will take any action, you should think that I am a member of a universal parliament. Okay, universal parliament, and my action will be implemented in each and every parts of the world, then my action will be well accepted. Okay, so this will be the answer of this question. So you will employ, you will subject Kantian theory of deontology, you will explain utilitarianism, consequentialism, and under utilitarianism, rule utilitarianism will be used, consequentialism, actual and foreseeable consequences, both must be taken into consideration, and lastly, your attitude and categorical imperatives. So you have to discuss all these things in the answer. Next question, with regard to the morality of action, one view is that means is of paramount importance, and other views is that the ends justify the means. Which view do you think is more appropriate? Justify your answer. बिल्कुल ऐसा ही लिखना है इसको, ठीक है? Means और ends पर, इसके लिए कुछ अलग नहीं है. बार बार recurrence हुआ है question का, repetition हो रहा है. Now our next question is, suppose the government of India is thinking of constructing a dam in a mountain valley bound by forest and inhabited by ethnic communities, what rational policy should it resort to in dealing with unforeseen contingencies? Okay, this is a situational question and a case study as well. So here you have to make a plan for the forest dwellers, where you are designing, you are constructing a dam. Okay, so there might be some negative consequences of the construction of this dam. So what will you do? How will you make rescue plan or rehabilitation plan? Okay, this is also a common question frequently asked by UPSC. क्या करेंगे आप इसमें सबसे पहले? First of all, we have to identify the symbiotic relationship between man and nature. Okay, these forest dwellers these forest dwellers depend on nature, forest, hana? Forest products, and generation to generation there is a long history of thousands of years. Okay, so if you will seize these forest products or lands of these forest dwellers, then it is difficult to rehabilitate these people because economically they are more dependent on forest products. Their practices, economic practices, are based on collection. Okay, forest products collection. So, कैसे करेंगे इसके लिए? क्या करेंगे rehabilitation plan के लिए हम? Unforeseen contingencies के लिए क्या plan करेंगे हम? पहला plan. ये डैम बनाया है, यहाँ पर जो लोग रह रहे हैं इनके लिए हमें प्लानिंग करनी है. तो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल असेस एनवायरमेंट इंपैक्ट असेसमेंट ईआईए. ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दिस ईआईए वी विल ट्राई टू आइडेंटिफाई द प्लेसेस विच कैन बी इन डेंजर इन फ्यूचर. So places which can be in danger in future, we will identify those places and we will make a rehabilitation of these people out of this area to other areas. But we will give utmost importance to search this area in terms of similarity. Okay, so these forest dwellers, if you rehabilitate these forest dwellers to city regions, okay, so they cannot survive. So you have to replace these people to similar type of environment. So you will replace them in forest villages, other forest villages. Okay, generally government क्या करती है कि road के side इनको rehabilitate कर देती है. जो भी forest village है उनको हटा के road के side में जब हम कर देते हैं तो फिर क्या होता है, इनकी पूरा जो economy है वो बहुत ही fragile होती है इनकी economy. Okay, तो ये economy क्या हो जाएगी, collapse हो जाएगी. And they cannot survive, and they will come under the influence of different evil practices. Okay, because in the absence of proper assets, proper money, proper sustainability, okay, so you will do this. Second, here rehabilitation plan employment. Providing employment, you can provide employment in terms of creating new agriculture land in new areas. Okay, so you can give forest rights provide kar sakte hain hum, hai na, hai na. We can provide land and we can implement MNREGA, MNREGA robustly. So we will implement MNREGA robustly in new areas. So we will provide 100 days employment, as well as we will provide the benefits of MNREGA scheme to make land as agriculture land. Okay, so बहुत सारे provisions होते हैं, जैसे bonds बनाने का provision, इससे demarcation भी हो जाएगा land का, ठीक है. और लैंड वाटरशेड की स्कीम्स हम यहां पे इंप्लीमेंट कर सकते हैं. वी कैन इंप्लीमेंट वाटरशेड स्कीम्स. नेक्स्ट लाइवलीहुड मिशन, लाइवलीहुड स्कीम्स टू स्ट्रेंथन द इकोनॉमी. ओके, एसएचजीज सेल्फ हेल्प ग्रुप के फॉर्म में एम्पावरमेंट कर सकते हैं इनका. In this way we can strengthen economically. And what about emotional attachment, emotional strengthening? We will replace these people to similar environment. Okay, Next, explain the process of resolving ethical dilemmas in public administration. Good question. Explain dilemma ko kaise hatayenge hum. Process of resolving ethical dilemma. So what is ethical dilemma? So firstly you will explain ethical dilemma. What is ethical dilemma? Dilemma kab hoti hai? Dilemma? While choosing an option, hana? While deciding your preference, your priority, then dilemma arises. So when you have more than one options, okay, and all these options are ethical. Not a single option is unethical, then it is ethical dilemma. Agar wo unethical hai to usme dilemma ki baat hi nahi hai, theek hai, wahan kya dilemma hoga. So all the options available are ethical, then you have to choose the best option, then you come in the situation of ethical dilemma. So how will you resolve this dilemma? First resolve karne ke liye, don't rush. Don't be hasty, don't rush to judgment. Find out as much as you can about what has happened. So first of all, you have to be well informed about the situations, hana? So all the nitty-gritties, all the essential knowledge must be known. Proper knowledge. So you have to set aside any type of ignorance, hana? Proper knowledge hame ho jaye, pehla kaam. Second, what will you do? Then you have to scrutinize these options in the light of the ethics of your organization. If you are in private organization, then there must be some ethical codes. So then you will see that these options are following those ethical codes or not. If these options are not following those ethical codes, they will be not taken into consideration. So these options will be reduced. So number of options will reduce. Okay. So second is taking into consideration code of ethics of your organization. Okay. So you will come to know what are the code of ethics. Then in the light of those code of ethics, you will scrutinize the available options. In the light of these code of ethics, you will scrutinize all the options. Third, you will also try to find out the emotions involved. Why? Your decision must be emotionally intelligent. Sometimes rational decision does not give proper answer. You have to be emotionally intelligent. You have to control your emotions. You have to control the emotions of others. Then you can choose the proper option. Third, talk the situation through a colleagues. You must talk to your near and dears, but people with same mindset, people who are having similar mental level. Ye nahi ki aap apni patni se discuss karne baith jaye, wo nahi bata payegi. If she does not possess proper knowledge, usse pata to hona chahiye. Usse kya discuss karoge? Log kya karte hain? Discussion kisse kar lete hain? Apne partner se discuss karte hain. भाई वो थोड़ी बताएगा. यू हैव टू डिस्कस योर सुपीरियर, यू हैव टू डिस्कस विद योर फ्रेंड्स कलीग्स हु आर हैविंग सेम मेंटल लेवल. सो डिस्कस with people having similar experience, then you will take options one by one. Option 1, 2, 3, these are different options. So you will make a set of these options, then you will make further a set of the consequences. Consequences of these actions means results R1, R2, R3, these results. Since all these options are ethical, so there is no need to choose most ethical option, okay, because all are ethical moral options. So here you will find out maxima of this set, maxima of the set of results of corresponding options. तो इनमें से जो मैक्सिमम रिजल्ट प्रोड्यूस करेगा तो आप उसको चूज करेंगे. यहां कौन सा प्रिंसिपल है? यूटिलिटेरियनिज्म. मैक्सिमम हैप्पीनेस फॉर मैक्सिमम नंबर ऑफ पीपल. सो हियर यू विल ट्राई टू इंक्रीज द हैप्पीनेस, ट्राई टू इंक्रीज द यूटिलिटी. ओके, यूटिलिटेरियनिज्म. यहां डियोन्टोलॉजी यूज नहीं करेंगे, है ना. जनरली आप देखेंगे कि जब भी एथिकल डिलेमा की बात होती है तो एथिकल डिलेमा में डियोन्टोलॉजी की बात करते हैं. तो डियोन्टोलॉजी नहीं है तभी तो हमें डिलेमा हुई है. इफ यू हैव क्लियर कट नॉलेज ऑफ डियोन्टोलॉजी, कोड्स, कंडक्ट्स, रूल्स, रेगुलेशन, सो ऑब्वियसली यू विल अवॉइड बाय दोज रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन. सो देयर इज नो डिलेमा. यू विल चूज द ऑप्शन विच आर अवॉइडिंग परफेक्ट रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन. ओके, सो यहाँ यूटिलिटेरियनिज्म प्रिंसिपल विल बी यूज. सो मैक्सिमम रिजल्ट प्रोड्यूसिंग ऑप्शन विल बी योर परफेक्ट चॉइस. Okay, then you will also try to take into consideration the public interest. जो ethical dilemma हुई है उसमें आपको ये भी पता होना चाहिए कि public की क्या सोच है, ठीक है. तो you can also include public interest, public considerations. Public क्या चाहती है, थोड़ा सा ये भी पता कर लिया जाए, है ना. Then you can come to know the proper option. So here dilemma will be resolved. Okay, so this was the question. Next question is, the true rule in determining to embrace or reject anything is not whether it has any evil in it, but whether it has more evil than good. There are few things wholly evil or wholly good. Almost everything, especially of government policy, is an inseparable compound of the two, so that our best judgment of the preponderance between them is continually demanded. Abraham Lincoln. क्या बोल रहा है ये क्वेश्चन? ये क्वेश्चन बोल रहा है, दिस क्वेश्चन सेज दैट व्हाइल मेकिंग अ गवर्नमेंट प्रोग्राम और स्कीम, इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल टू टेक इनटू कंसीडरेशन ऑल द गुड्स एंड डिस्पेल आउट ऑल द इविल्स, है ना. इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल, है ना. तो व्हाट यू डू, यू ट्राई टू इंक्रीज the pleasure or good and diminish, try to diminish pain or evil or bad. Okay, so koi bhi program banayenge to hum kya koshish karenge, we will try to increase the good results, and evil results are complementary always, hai na. They come with goods, hai na, because good is nothing without evil. You cannot define good. What is good? Hana? If beauty is good, so existence of beauty depends upon the existence of ugliness. अगर ugly नहीं हो तो beauty को कौन मानेगा? तो good और evil हमेशा साथ में चलते हैं, है ना. So good and evil run parallel. So you cannot dispel out evil completely. Okay, so this is the statement of Abraham Lincoln. So how will you explain this in governance or in administration? कैसे करेंगे? एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन में इसका यूज क्या है? कैसे एक्सप्लेन करेंगे? फर्स्ट, सो वी विल टेक द हेल्प ऑफ मोरल फिलोसफर्स ऑफ ग्रीक मोरल फिलोसफर्स. सो दिस ग्रीक मोरल फिलोसफर्स आर टेलियोलॉजिस्ट. दे टॉक्स अबाउट एंड्स. हियर एंड इज हैप्पीनेस. ओके, दे गिव डिफरेंट मीनिंग्स ऑफ हैप्पीनेस, बट दे आर इंट्रिंसिक टेलियोलॉजिस्ट. इंट्रिंसिक टेलियोलॉजिस्ट जनरली टेलियोलॉजिकल प्रिंसिपल्स आर डिवाइन टेलियोलॉजी. ओके, बट ग्रीक फिलोसफर्स डू नॉट एम्फेसाइज ओवर डिवाइन टेलियोलॉजी, दे आर इंट्रिंसिक टेलियोलॉजिस्ट. ओके, डिवाइनिटी की बात नहीं करते वो, डिवाइन है ना, तो गॉड को नहीं लाते हैं वो, हैप्पीनेस को गॉड से डिफाइन नहीं करते. तो इन टर्म्स ऑफ अटेनिंग हैप्पीनेस एज परफेक्ट एंड्स, दे टॉक अबाउट वर्च्यूज, सद्गुणों की बात करते हैं. ठीक है, सो व्हाइल डिफाइनिंग द वर्च्यूज दे से दैट वर्च्यूज आर द गोल्डन मीन बिटवीन टू वाइसेस. सो एरिस्टोटल सेज, एरिस्टोटल क्या कहता है, इज एरिस्टोटल क्या कहता है, वर्च्यू इज द गोल्डन मीन बिटवीन टू वाइसेस. गोल्डन मीन बिटवीन टू वाइसेस, इट मीन्स यू कैन नॉट डिस्पेल आउट ईविल कंप्लीटली. ओके, यू कैन नॉट अटेन मैक्सिमम हैप्पीनेस. ओके, यू हैव टू फाइंड आउट द मीन वेयर देयर इज परफेक्ट बैलेंस बिटवीन टू एक्सट्रीम पोजिशंस. ये दो एक्सट्रीम पोजिशंस हैं, इनके बीच की वैल्यू आपको निकालनी होगी, क्योंकि आप किसी एक एक्सट्रीम पर नहीं रह सकते. तो गवर्नमेंट के प्रोग्राम को बनाते समय भी हम इस गोल्डन मीन की खोज करते हैं कि ऐसा कौन सा मीन वाला पॉइंट हम फाइंड आउट कर लें. ठीक है, तो स्कीम इफिशियंटली इंप्लीमेंट हो सके. एरिस्टोटल के बाद बुद्धा, गौतम बुद्धा, ही ऑल्सो टॉक्स अबाउट मिडिल पाथ. मिडिल पाथ है ना, नेक्स्ट क्रिश्चियन थियोलॉजिस्ट थॉमस एक्विनास. थॉमस एक्विनास एक्सप्लेन्स डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस. एक्चुअली ही एक्सप्लेन्स जस्टिस एज जनरल जस्टिस एंड पार्टिकुलर जस्टिस अंडर फर्स्ट कैटेगरी एंड इन सेकेंड कैटेगरी. ही डिस्क्राइब्स जस्टिस एज कम्यूटेटिव जस्टिस एंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस. तो डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस ये अभी यहाँ पर स्कोप नहीं है, हम यहाँ डिटेल में समझें, बस ये समझिए आप डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस क्या है. डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस इज अबाउट टू डिस्पेल आउट द डिस्पैरिटीज. तो डिस्पैरिटीज को भी हटाना होता है. बहुत सारी लेवल प्लेइंग फील्ड, इफ यू हैव टू मेंटेन लेवल प्लेइंग फील्ड देन you have to take some affirmative actions. Example of such affirmative actions are reservation policies hai na, so reservation policies creating some evil effect. Some segment of society says reservation policies have evil effects, but to decide the positive effects in terms of affirmative actions for downtrodden weaker sections of the society, this is creating good. Okay, so this is a policy which is creating good as well as evil. For a certain section it may be evil, but commonly it is a good policy. MNREGA, MNREGA. MNREGA is beneficial for marginal farmers, okay, for SCST communities, and we are not able to give the benefits of MNREGA to advance or forward people who are economically backward, but they are economically backward, socially they are forward. So here MNREGA is bringing about good, and but some people understand that it is not beneficial for them. Okay, so any of the government scheme carries equal good and equal evils. Okay, next, JAM, Jandan Aadhaar Mobile Number, JAM Trinity, है ना? तो इसमें भी बहुत सारी बातें आ रही हैं कि इसके evil effects हैं, but it is also having some good effects, बहुत सारे अच्छे इसके प्रभाव हैं, है ना? तो good और bad दोनों एक साथ चलेंगे, okay? तो यही ये पूछ रहे हैं यहाँ पर. तो इन schemes का आप example दे सकते हैं, MNREGA, DBT, Direct Benefit Transfer, good and bad दोनों ही इफेक्ट हैं इसके, है ना? जैसे अभी रिसेंटली न्यूज में आया था ना, उत्तर प्रदेश में a family died of hunger because they could not make authentication under DBT स्कीम इन फूड सिक्योरिटी एक्ट, है ना? तो DBT में वो जब थंब इंप्रेशन उनका काम नहीं कर रहा है तो उनको प्रोविजन जो था फूड का वो नहीं मिल पाया, तो इविल इफेक्ट क्रिएट कर रहा है. बट इट इज चेकिंग दी पिल्फरेज, है ना? चोरियां जो होती थी अनाज की, है ना, जो लीकेज था उसको इसने कम कर दिया, खत्म कर दिया. तो गुड एंड इविल दोनों ही इसके साथ आ रहे हैं. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, anger and intolerance are the enemies of correct understanding. Anger and intolerance are enemies of correct understanding. So this question is related to socio-psychological part of ethics, your syllabus. Okay. Anger and intolerance. क्या कर रहे हैं इंटॉलरेंस? आर द एनिमीज ऑफ करेक्ट अंडरस्टैंडिंग. करेक्ट अंडरस्टैंडिंग इट मींस राइट नॉलेज. इट मींस एंगर एंड इंटॉलरेंस क्रिएट्स इग्नोरेंस. Anger and intolerance diminishes the power of your cognitive faculties. तो intellectual का जो power है उसको कम कर देता है, इसका मतलब है anger and intolerance. So you will explain this question under philosophical ground. So what are the philosophical grounds to explain anger and intolerance? Actually, this anger and intolerance are passions. Passions हैं ये, negative passions. Negative passion है, है ना? तो negative passions हैं तो ये क्या करते हैं? Negative passions, they create ignorance. ये ignorance को create कर देते हैं. And इससे क्या होगा? जो action होगा, that action will not be proper action. ठीक है? तो ये negative passions हैं. तो ये negative passions क्या करेंगे? It means this negative passion so now we will take aptitude help of the concept of aptitude. So aptitude has three component, A, B, C component. A is affective component, B is behavioral, and C is cognitive. Ab dekhiye, हम यहां पर इस कोशिश करेंगे इससे इसको जोड़ने का. एंगर एंड इंटॉलरेंस, अफेक्टिव मतलब इमोशंस. सो इन द इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ एंगर एंड इंटॉलरेंस योर इमोशंस डज नॉट गाइड प्रॉपरली, है ना? बिकॉज दीज आर नेगेटिव इमोशंस, सो नेगेटिव इमोशंस विल गाइड नेगेटिवली. ठीक है? तो आपका जो एप्टीट्यूड होगा दैट विल नॉट बी अ प्रॉपर एप्टीट्यूड, सॉरी एटीट्यूड. proper attitude. So this anger and intolerance will create negative emotions. Okay, so this is not going to guide you properly. Next is cognitive component. A cognitive component is about knowledge component. Okay, for certain period of time your knowledge will be covered by the ignorance. Okay, ignorance will encroach the field of your knowledge, so your knowledge will be blurred or vague and you will not be in a state of correct behavior, to conduct correct behavior. So to overcome the situation of anger and intolerance, you must be emotionally intelligent. Hai na, emotionally intelligent hona chahiye aapko. If you are an emotionally intelligent person, then you can regulate these negative emotions. Okay, you will not come under the influence of these negative emotions and your behavioral component will be always perfect. Proper behavior will be conducted. Okay, so this will be the explanation. Next question is, falsehood takes the place of truth when it results in unblemished common good. Tirukural. देखिए, अब इससे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता कि किसने स्टेटमेंट दिया, तिरुकुरल दें या गांधी जी दें, है ना? हमारा काम क्या है, वी हैव टू एक्सप्लेन द स्टेटमेंट्स अंडर फिलोसफिकल स्क्रूटनी, फिलोसफिकल इन्वेस्टिगेशन, है ना? तो हम जो भी बात कहते हैं, सो अवर स्टेटमेंट मस्ट बी सपोर्टेड बाय स्टेटमेंट्स ऑफ फिलोसफर्स. हाँ, हमारे स्टेटमेंट्स की कोई कीमत नहीं है, कोई वैल्यू नहीं है. ठीक है, हमारे स्टेटमेंट्स कन्फॉर्मिटी रहना चाहिए उसकी, फिलोसफर्स के साथ. तो यहां पर तिरुकुरल कह रहे हैं कि फॉल्सहुड टेक्स द प्लेस ऑफ ट्रूथ व्हेन इट रिजल्ट्स इन अनब्लेमिश्ड कॉमन गुड. कॉमन गुड इसे चाहिए. एंड ही सेइंग कॉमन गुड को अचीव करना है तो यू कैन टेक द हेल्प ऑफ फॉल्सहुड ऑल्सो टू अचीव दिस. तो आप कैसे बताएंगे इसको? हियर कॉमन गुड इज अबाउट एंड्स, कॉमन एंड्स ऑफ a society, particular society. So Tirukular is talking about common goods. Common goods matlab society ke liye, good ke liye, not a individual good. He is not talking about individual good. For common good, you falsehood, you can even lie. So kaise explain karenge? You can see that here he is emphasizing on ends. Whatever the means doesn't matter. Okay, so teleological principle yahan par aayega. So you have to explain, as you explained in previous question, we will explain about teleology. Next, you will explain duty and rights. Okay, you will also explain स्टेटमेंट ऑफ कांट अबाउट लाय. कांट क्या कहते हैं झूठ के बारे में? तो कांट सेज दैट इन एनी ऑफ द सर्कमस्टेंसेस यू शुड ऑलवेज टेल ट्रूथ. देर इज नो स्कोप ऑफ टेलिंग लाय. ओके, बिकॉज यू डू नॉट नो द एक्चुअल कॉन्सिक्वेंसेज. हाउ कैन यू से दैट माई लाय विल प्रोड्यूस कॉमन गुड? यू कैन नॉट से. इट कैन बी अ टेम्पररी result, but in long duration you will see that this lie will create negative results. Okay, duty and rights, every person, common good is about social contact theory. So social contact theories give different duties and different rights to each and every member of the society. So every member of a society stands in different duties, different relationships, and every duty complements with a right. So agar mera bolne ka adhikar hai, right to speech, if I have right to speech, then I have a duty to tell truth. Your duty to tell truth is associated with your duty to your right to speech. So if you want to exercise your right to speech, then you have to perform this duty, duty to tell truth. Okay, so here duties are of two types. First is prima facie duty, prima facie, and second is actual duty. Okay, so you have to understand, after weighing the different decisions, weighing different circumstances, then you have to decide the prima facie and actual duty. Like अगर मैं बात करूं कि किसी को झूठ बोला आपने, कोई झूठ बोलते हैं आप, लाए कर बोलते हैं, तो उससे कितना रिजल्ट प्रोड्यूस होगा इन टर्म्स ऑफ मैग्नीट्यूड, है ना? सो यू हैव टू टेक इनटू कंसीडरेशन फोरसीएबल रिजल्ट्स, आल्सो एक्चुअल रिजल्ट्स, देन यू विल डिसाइड. हियर प्राइमा फेसी ड्यूटी, प्राइमा फेसी ड्यूटी जो हमें सामने दिखती है कि हमारी ड्यूटी, बट दिस इज नॉट एक्चुअल ड्यूटी. जैसे एग्जाम्पल के तौर पर हम देखें, यू आर passing through and you see an accident and you are going to take an interview of UPSC, then your actual duty is to take interview. Here you cannot stop your car and give medical facilities to that person. Okay, your duty is to just intimate, dial 100 or ambulance, that is your duty. And rest of the duties lying to other people, hana? Different people have different services, they are assigned different duties, so they will perform their duties. So as it is said by Aristotle, doing your own job, Plato, doing your own work, own things. तो प्लेटो ने भी ये कहा है कि अपना अपना काम करते रहो, है ना? बिकॉज ईच एंड एवरी मेंबर ऑफ ए सोसाइटी इज असाइंड पर्टिकुलर ड्यूटी, स्पेसिफिक ड्यूटी, एंड यू मस्ट नॉट इंटरफियर द ड्यूटीज ऑफ अदर्स. यू आर नॉट अ डॉक्टर, सो यू विल नॉट प्रोवाइड मेडिकल फैसिलिटी टू दोज विक्टिम्स. ओके, तो यहां आप अपना काम करें. आपका काम क्या है? यू शुड इंटीमेट एम्बुलेंस, यू शुड कॉल एम्बुलेंस, है ना? अब कार नहीं रोक देंगे आप अपने इंटरव्यू के लिए जाएंगे, ठीक है? तो यहां पर यह समझना जरूरी है कि आपकी प्राइमा फेसी ड्यूटी क्या है और एक्चुअल ड्यूटी क्या है. तो मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम पीपल आर कंफ्यूज इन प्राइमा फेसी ड्यूटी, है ना? दे टेक प्राइमा फेसी ड्यूटी एज हिज एक्चुअल ड्यूटी. तो यहां पर प्रॉब्लम क्रिएट होगी. तो जब भी हम लाए करें तो हमें यह देखना जरूरी है कि क्या हम अपनी एक्चुअल ड्यूटी को परफॉर्म कर रहे हैं, ठीक है? तो अगर उससे एक्चुअल ड्यूटी परफॉर्म हो रही है, देन यू कैन लाइ. तो अब कुछ केस स्टडीज हैं, तो हम इसको थोड़ा सा जल्दी से डिस्कस कर लेंगे, कुछ एसेंशियल पार्ट्स हैं इसके, ठीक है? बहुत ज्यादा हम इसको एक्सप्लेन नहीं करेंगे, जो पॉइंट्स हैं उनको डिस्कस कर लेंगे. तो राकेश इज अ रिस्पॉन्सिबल डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल ऑफिसर हु एंजॉयज द ट्रस्ट ऑफ हिज हायर ऑफिशियल्स. Knowing his honesty, the government entrusted him with the responsibility of identifying the beneficiaries under a healthcare scheme meant for senior citizens. The criteria to be a beneficiary are following: 60 years of age or above, belonging to a reserved category, family income of less than 1 lakh rupees per annum, post-treatment prognosis is likely to be high to make a positive difference to the quality of life of the beneficiary. One day, an old couple visited Rakesh's office with their application. They have been the residents of a village in his district since their birth. The old man is diagnosed with a rare condition that causes obstruction in the large intestine. Okay. As a consequence, he has severe abdominal pain frequently that prevents him from doing any physical labor. The couple has no children to support them. The expert surgeon whom they contacted is willing to do the surgery without charging any fee. However, the couple will have to bear the cost of incidental charges such as medicines, hospitalization, etc. to the tune of rupees 1 lakh. The couple fulfills all the criteria except criterion B. B means belonging to reserve category. So they do not belong to a reserve category, but it is an essential criteria. However, any financial aid would certainly make a significant difference in their quality of life. So how will you respond? How will Rakesh should respond? How will Rakesh respond? कैसे रिस्पॉन्ड करेगा? फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, इन एनी केस स्टडी यू हैव टू फाइंड आउट द एथिकल क्वेश्चंस और इश्यूज इन्वॉल्व इन केस स्टडीज. कौन कौन से एथिकल इश्यूज इन्वॉल्व हैं? तो एथिकल इश्यूज कौन से इन्वॉल्व हैं, आपको कुछ समझने की जरूरत नहीं. अपने सिलेबस को उठाइए, यूनिट वन से जो सिलेबस है वही एथिकल इश्यूज हैं. नहीं तो क्या है सिलेबस? डायमेंशंस ऑफ एथिक्स. ऑब्वियसली हियर डायमेंशंस इज, हियर डायमेंशन इज डियोंटोलॉजी वर्सेस टेलियोलॉजी. ये नियम को मान ले, वो कैटेगरी बी को माना जाए, कंसिडरेशन में लिया जाए कि नहीं लिया जाए. डियोंटोलॉजी, टेलीलॉजी कहती है कि उसको हेल्प करना जरूरी है बिकॉज ही इज डाइंग ऑफ हिज डिजीज, है ना, इट इज पेनफुल. नेक्स्ट एथिकल इशू, कंपैशन टुवर्ड वीकर सेक्शन, कंपैशन टुवर्ड्स वीकर सेक्शन. नेक्स्ट इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस, इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस, एम्पैथी. सिविल सर्विसेज वैल्यूज, सो दीज आर दी एथिकल इश्यूज इन्वॉल्व इन दिस केस स्टडी. सो व्हाट राकेश शुड डू, राकेश को क्या करना चाहिए? ऑब्वियसली ही शुड फॉलो डियोंटोलॉजी. And this is not the perfect case to give benefit of government scheme. Okay, तो इस तरह की बहुत सी health schemes होती हैं जो local level पे जो administration होता है वो provide करते हैं, है ना. State इसके लिए rules बनाते हैं, regulations बनाते हैं, कुछ essential जो norms है वो बनाते हैं. Here this family is not fulfilling norms B, which is saying belonging to a reserved community, and they are not belonging to a reserved community, so they do not fit the bill. So what will Rakesh do? We will see after some time. Compassion towards weaker section, so compassion towards weaker section says that he should do something for them, but there is a conduct rule that a civil servant or a public servant cannot collect money for any purpose, kisi bhi purpose ke liye, whether it is good or bad, it is a social cause. He cannot collect money, है ना. ये नहीं कि वो चंदा इकट्ठा करने लगे कि अच्छा काम करना है, नहीं, अगेंस्ट है ये कंडक्ट रूल्स के. फिर क्या करेगा वो? ये भी नहीं कर सकता कि कलेक्शन कर ले अपने ऑफिस से और उसकी उसका ट्रीटमेंट करा दें, ये भी गलत हो जाएगा. इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस इज रिक्वायर्ड बिकॉज विदाउट इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस ही कैन नॉट अंडरस्टैंड द इमोशंस ऑफ दैट एग्रीव पर्सन, एंड एट द सेम टाइम ही हैज टू regulate his emotions, otherwise he will take any wrong decision which will jeopardize his career also, which can jeopardize his career. अगर उसने पैसा उगवा लिया, शिकायत हो गई उसकी, तो उसकी suspension हो जाएगा, departmental inquiries हो जाएंगी. So emotionally intelligent होना जरूरी है, उसको अपने emotions को अब regulate करेगा वो. Next is empathy. Empathy is about understanding the emotions of other people, keeping yourself, putting yourself in his place, his or her place. That is empathy. Values, public services values. What are values? Efficiency in governance. This is a value. this is a value, efficiency, efficient governance, effective governance, it means reasonableness, okay, minimum expenditure mein maximum logon ko usko hai na misuse nahi karna expenditure ka, theek hai, utilization of public money, it is important. So ab ye kaise decision lega, these are the ethical issues, some are moral, some are ethical, some are legal, some are related to emotional aspects. क्या करना चाहिए इसको, इसको काम क्या दिया गया है, he has to make a list of potent beneficiaries, है ना, तो जो potent beneficiaries है उनकी list बनाना है, तो ये क्या करेगा, यहां beneficiary की list में he will not add the name of that family, so now, but he will try to help that family by giving inputs in policy making, okay, he will take it as a case study and he will put his representation in front of government, kyunki policies government banati hai, department policy nahi banata, theek hai, to government ke samne wo rakh sakta hai, hai na, par ye kaise rakhega, inputs kaise rakhega, through proper channel, है ना, क्योंकि वो डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल का ऑफिसर है, डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल का ऑफिसर है तो सीधे गवर्नमेंट से करस्पॉन्डेंस नहीं कर सकता, है ना, तो करस्पॉन्डेंस कौन करेगा, डिस्ट्रिक्ट कलेक्टर करेगा उसका, ओके, सो ही विल एक्सप्लेन ऑल दीज थिंग्स टू हिज डिस्ट्रिक्ट कलेक्टर, देन थ्रू प्रॉपर चैनल दे विल डू अ करस्पॉन्डेंस एंड दे विल ट्राई टू अमेंड द पॉलिसीज, rules, norms, and then they could help those aggrieved people, है ना, इस तरह से कर सकता है, यहाँ पर आपको बिल्कुल भी emotional नहीं होना है, है ना, कि बहुत सारे लोग इस तरह से लिखते हैं कि हमने उसके लिए पैसा इकट्ठा कर लेंगे, ठीक है ना, इस तरह से, तो ये सब आप नहीं कर सकते, सैलरी से हम पैसा दे देंगे, कोई नहीं देता सैलरी से पैसा, देखिए ये केस स्टडीज में इम्पॉर्टेंट है, दे ट्राई टू चेक योर इंटीग्रिटी, मतलब आप जो लिख रहे हैं वर्ड्स जो हैं आपके, है ना, और जो आपके थॉट्स हैं, है ना, और जो आपका एक्शन होगा, ये कन्फॉर्मिटी होगी या नहीं, कोई नहीं किसी के लिए चंदा इकट्ठा करता, अपनी सैलरी में से कोई नहीं देता, ठीक है, देता है क्या, नहीं देता, जनरल है एक्शन, तो इसको एक्सेप्ट करो ना भाई, यू हैव टू एक्सेप्ट इट, यू कैन नॉट राइट मैनिपुलेटिव वर्ड्स इन योर कॉपी, वो कह देगा भाई ये तो अभी से इसकी इंटीग्रिटी डाउटफुल हो गई, ठीक है ना, तो आपको प्रॉपर एक्शन लेना होगा, इसके बाद जो आप उसकी हेल्प कर सकते हैं थ्रू प्रॉपर चैनल इन लीगल वे यू विल डू दैट, ओके, नेक्स्ट केस स्टडी है, सीनियर ऑफिसर हैं आप मिनिस्ट्री के, यू हैव एक्सेस टू इंपॉर्टेंट पॉलिसी डिसीजंस एंड अपकमिंग बिग अनाउंसमेंट सच एज रोड कंस्ट्रक्शन प्रोजेक्ट्स before they are notified in public domain, the ministry is about to announce a mega road project for which the drawings are already in place, sufficient care was taken by the planners to make use of the government land with minimum land acquisition from private parties, compensation rate for private parties was also finalized as per government rules, care was also taken to minimize deforestation, once the project is announced it is expected that there will be a huge spurt in real estate prices in and around that area. Meanwhile, the minister concerned insists that you realign the road in such a way that it comes closer to his 20 acres farmhouse. He also suggests that he would facilitate the purchase of a big plot of land in your wife's name at the prevailing rate, which is very nominal, in and around the proposed mega road project. He also tries to convince you by saying that there is no harm in it as he is buying the land legally. He even promises to supplement your savings in case you do not have sufficient funds to buy the land. However, by the act of realignment, a lot of agricultural lands has to be acquired, thereby causing a considerable financial burden on the government and also the displacement of the farmers. As if This is not enough. It will involve cutting down of a large number of trees, denuding the area of its green cover. What will you do? Critically examine various conflict of interest and explain what your responsibilities are as a public servant. बहुत लंबी चौड़ी केस स्टडी है. सेंट्रल आइडिया इसका ये है. दिस इज अ हाईवे प्रोजेक्ट. ओके, सो एक्सपर्ट्स हैव आइडेंटिफाइड द अलाइनमेंट एंड देयर इज अ लार्ज चंक ऑफ लैंड ऑफ अ मिनिस्टर एंड दिस मिनिस्टर वांट्स टू रीअलाइन दिस रोड इन दिस वे. Because this will increase and hence the prices of his land. So this will give monetary benefit and he tries to convince you that he will give profit if because you can realign this road. So you have power to realign this road, so you will be get profited by this minister. So what will you do? So yahan pe kaun kaun se conflicts aa rahe hain? तो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट में क्या कॉन्फ्लिक्ट आएंगे? पहला तो पब्लिक का इंटरेस्ट होना चाहिए. ओके, पब्लिक के इंटरेस्ट में क्या होगा? कौन कौन से इंटरेस्ट इसमें अगेंस्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट किससे होगा? आपके प्राइवेट पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट से. यहां ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल इंटरेस्ट तो है नहीं, पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट है. तो पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट है तो आपके जो पर्सनल इंटरेस्ट कौन कौन से होंगे? पेक्यूनरी बेनिफिट्स आपको मिलेंगे. मास्टर प्लान आपको पता है, आप लैंड ले लेंगे वहां पर, इससे आप बाद में उस लैंड की प्राइसेस बढ़ जाएंगे. ठीक है, तो डिस्क्लोजर ऑफ कॉन्फिडेंशियल इंफॉर्मेशन अगेंस्ट कंडक्ट रूल्स. यह कंडक्ट रूल के अगेंस्ट होती है, आप डिस्क्लोज नहीं कर सकते जब तक उसका नोटिफिकेशन नहीं हो जाता, तब तक आप डिस्क्लोज नहीं कर सकते मास्टर प्लान को. ठीक है, तो ये पेक्यूनरी बेनिफिट्स. नेक्स्ट, रिलेशंस आपके स्ट्रांग हो जाएंगे मिनिस्टर से, ये आपके बेनिफिट्स हैं. नेक्स्ट, फियर, डर, करेज ऑफ कन्विक्शन, साहस. तो एक डर होता है, उससे आप बच जाएंगे, है ना, डरने की जरूरत नहीं है फिर आपको, क्योंकि यू आर हेल्पिंग दैट मिनिस्टर, सो ही विल हेल्प यू आउट. तो रेसिप्रोसिटी ऑफ रिलेशनशिप यहां पर काम करेंगे. ठीक है, ये तो आपके इंटरेस्ट हो गए. पब्लिक का इंटरेस्ट क्या है? मिनिमम एक्विजिशन होना चाहिए. लैंड एक्विजिशन मिनिमम होना चाहिए, है ना, नहीं तो फार्मर्स विल बी डीपोजेस्ड बाय देयर पेरेंट लैंड्स, है ना, एंड दे आर इमोशनली अटैच्ड टू देयर लैंड्स. So this will also create the condition of law and order. Sometime it creates the condition of law and order. Phir jiske alignment ke liye itna manpower use hua tha, realignment will again put that much manpower here and large number of acquisition is taking place. So more manpower will be required. Okay, so manpower ka misuse. इसका मिसयूज होगा. फिर ये जो प्रोजेक्ट है ये क्या होगा? लिंगर ऑन हो जाएगा. तो प्रोजेक्ट जब बढ़ जाएगा तो क्या होगा? कॉस्ट रन एंड बिकॉज ऑफ द कॉस्ट रन मोस्ट ऑफ द प्रोजेक्ट्स आर इन एबियंस, है ना. Contractors are not in state to complete those projects because of certain law and order like conditions or other conditions, hai na. Land acquisition was not done by properly, to iske karan bahut se project badh jate hain, cost run ho jayega. Aaj jo project 100 crore mein banne wala hai wo kal jaake 125 crore mein badh jayega, cost run ho jayega. Complete nahi hoga to quality se samjhauta karna padega, hai na. You have to compromise the quality. नेक्स्ट, कन्वर्जन, ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ लैंड यूटिलाइजेशन, चेंज इन लैंड यूटिलाइजेशन, लैंड यूज पैटर्न, लैंड यूज का पैटर्न चेंज हो जाएगा. एग्रीकल्चर लैंड विल कन्वर्ट इन टू कमर्शियल लैंड, है ना. सो डिक्रीज इन एग्रीकल्चर लैंड विल डिक्रीज दी एग्रीकल्चर प्रोडक्शन. इट विल ऑल्सो गिव ब्लो टू दी इकोनॉमिक कंडीशन ऑफ फार्मर्स, है ना. दिस विल प्रूव टू बी अ डेथ ब्लो टू दी कंडीशन ऑफ द फार्मर्स. जब फार्मर्स के पास काम यही था, अगर आप उसकी लैंड छुड़ा लोगे तो क्या करेंगे उस पैसे का, वो खर्च कर देंगे. एनवायरमेंट डिग्रेडेशन बिकॉज ऑफ डिफॉरेस्टेशन, एनवायरमेंट डिग्रेडेशन, एनवायरमेंट गिर जाए. तो इतने सारे इंटरेस्ट के साथ आपके कॉन्फ्लिक्ट हो रहा है. आपका इंटरेस्ट केवल एक इंटरेस्ट, पेक्यूनरी इंटरेस्ट, ठीक है. आपके मिनिस्टर का इंटरेस्ट, क्योंकि फियर भी है आपने, और ये यहां पर इतने सारे इंटरेस्ट हैं, तो इनके बीच में कॉन्फ्लिक्ट होगा. अब कैसे डिसाइड करोगे आप, हाउ यू विल डिसाइड, कैसे करेंगे आप डिसाइड. ऑब्वियसली कंडक्ट रूल सेज देयर शुड बी परफेक्ट इंटीग्रिटी इन योर एक्शन, नो डिस्क्लोजर ऑफ एनी प्रोजेक्ट्स बिफोर नोटिफिकेशन इन पब्लिक डोमेन, तो आप इसका डिस्क्लोजर नहीं करेंगे, ठीक है. नो रीअलाइनमेंट विल टेक प्लेस बिकॉज दिस अलाइनमेंट हैज बीन डन बाय एक्सपर्ट्स, एक्सपर्ट्स ने इस अलाइनमेंट को किया है, ठीक है. तो आप इसमें आप करेंगे तो इट कैन ऑल्सो जिपरडाइज योर करियर. इफ एनी डिपार्टमेंटल इंक्वायरी इज हेल्ड देन यू कैन बी पनिश्ड. सो दिस विल जिपरडाइज योर करियर. आगे और क्या आर्ग्यूमेंट्स हैं, कंपैशन टुवर्ड्स वीकर सेक्शन, दिस इज फाउंडेशनल वैल्यू ऑफ सिविल सर्विस, है ना. वीकर सेक्शन को आप इस तरह से सप्रेस नहीं कर सकते, ओके. लॉ एंड ऑर्डर की कंडीशंस क्रिएट हो जाएंगी, दिस कंडीशन ऑफ लॉ एंड ऑर्डर, है ना. अभी हम देखते हैं फॉर्मर अनरेस्ट के फॉर्म में दिखता है ना. तो ये सारी चीजें हैं, तो इनको कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट को इस तरह से हम इसको रिजोल्व करेंगे, और हमको जो रोड है जहां अलाइनमेंट था वहीं पे रोड बनाएंगे, ओके. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, मैं अब पूरा पढ़ के नहीं सुनाता हूं, सीधे केस स्टडी आपको बता देता हूं. यू आर ए सुपरिंटेंडेंट पुलिस ऑफ ए डिस्ट्रिक्ट एंड योर डिस्ट्रिक्ट इज फेसिंग द प्रॉब्लम ऑफ इलीगल लिकर, ओके, बूज. एंड इन लीगल वेज यू हैव कम टू अंडरस्टैंड, you have come to understood that in legal ways you cannot eradicate this evil of society. So what will you do, kya karoge aap isko hatane ke liye, dande ki taagat se nahi ho pa raha hai ye, to kya karna chahiye iske liye, aapko kuch suggestion dena hai. To hum short mein dekh lete hain kya suggestion ho sakte hain, yahan par kaun sa important hoga, persuasion. This is a case study of persuasion, attitude change, है ना. You can change the attitude with the help of persuasion. It means logos. You will use the power of logos as given by sophist. Logos, rhetorical persuasion. Next, emotional intelligence. इंटेलिजेंस, लीडरशिप, कंपैशन टुवर्ड्स वीकर सेक्शन, वीकर सेक्शन, ओके. सिविल सर्विसेज वैल्यूज, कोऑर्डिनेशन, कोऑर्डिनेशन. पुलिस नहीं कर सकती अकेले, कोऑर्डिनेशन करना पड़ेगा, कोऑर्डिनेशन विद अदर डिपार्टमेंट्स, पब्लिक, social workers, celebrities. Here celebrities, not I am not talking about heroes of movies, hai na, yeah, celebrities are popular figures, hai na. So persuasion karke attitude change karne ki koshish karenge, hai na. To persuasion ki jitni bhi technique hai usko aap thoda sa explain karenge, how to pursue, hai na. Different techniques hain, kaise hain different techniques, source, message, kis tarah ka message design karna hai, theek hai, output kis tarah se aayenge, theek hai. Jaise example CLTS, Swach Bharat Mission mein CLTS community led total sanitation karte hain, hai na. This is a scientific method, hai na, to make India free from open defecation. In the same manner we will design a persuasion on the basis of the different methods of attitude change, है ना. बिहेवियर कॉम्पोनेंट को चेंज करना है हमें, इसके लिए हम परसुएशन का यूज करेंगे. इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस, रेगुलेट इमोशंस ऑफ अदर्स, रेगुलेट इमोशंस ऑफ योर पार्टिसिपेंट्स विच आर हु आर विलिंग टू कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू एरेडिकेट दिस ईविल प्रैक्टिस, है ना. जैसे कौन है आपके कोऑर्डिनेशन में अदर डिपार्टमेंट्स के साथ कोऑर्डिनेशन, जैसे यहां पर खासतौर से जो डिसेंट्रलाइज्ड एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन है, लोकल सेल्फ गवर्नमेंट, इसके साथ आपको कोऑर्डिनेशन करना पड़ेगा. पंचायती राज इंस्टीट्यूशंस, है ना, इन अर्बन एरियाज एज वेल एज इन रूरल एरियाज, पंचायती राज इंस्टीट्यूशन, लोकल सेल्फ गवर्नमेंट्स, ठीक है. तो इनके साथ आपको कोऑर्डिनेशन करना होगा, बिकॉज दीज आर दी की इंस्टीट्यूशंस, है ना, बिकॉज दीज इंस्टीट्यूशन सर्व कॉमन पब्लिक एंड दे हैव ग्रेटर होल्ड इन द पब्लिक देन अ पुलिस ऑफिसर. पुलिस ऑफिसर परसुएशन नहीं कर सकता क्योंकि वो सर्विस प्रोवाइडर है ही नहीं, वो तो सिक्योरिटी प्रोवाइडर है, ठीक है. ये पंचायती राज इंस्टीट्यूशंस को आप, ये आपकी बात मान सकते हैं, पब्लिक आपकी बात नहीं मानेगी. तो विद द हेल्प ऑफ दीज डिपार्टमेंट्स, अब हेल्प कैसे, आप सीधे ऑर्डर रिलीज नहीं कर सकते, यू हैव टू टेक द हेल्प ऑफ डिस्ट्रिक्ट कलेक्टर, है ना. सो यू विल टेक द हेल्प ऑफ डिस्ट्रिक्ट कलेक्टर, सब डिविजनल मजिस्ट्रेट्स, तहसीलदार, ओके, BDOs, ब्लॉक डेवलपमेंट ऑफिसर, चीफ म्युनिसिपल ऑफिसर्स, है ना. विद द हेल्प ऑफ दीज ऑफिसर्स यू कैन स्टार्ट ए ड्राइव, एक ड्राइव स्टार्ट कर सकते हैं आप. कंपैशन टुवर्ड्स वीकर सेक्शन, ये आपको मोटिवेट करेगी, आपके अंदर मोटिवेशन भी होना चाहिए. इनिशियली यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू प्रोड्यूस रिजल्ट्स, सो दिस मोटिवेशन इज रिक्वायर्ड, है ना, क्योंकि ये तो लॉन्ग टर्म में होता है, किसी भी इविल को खत्म करना है तो, ठीक है. तो इसके लिए मोटिवेशन आपको कहाँ से आएगा, यहाँ से मोटिवेशन आएगा. लीडरशिप इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, यू हैव टू लीड द टीम, है ना. तो इस तरह से आप इस केस स्टडी को करेंगे, है ना. सेलिब्रिटीज का यूज कर सकते हैं आप, है ना, वहाँ के जो लोकल लीडर्स हैं उनका यूज करेंगे हम, ठीक है. नेक्स्ट केस स्टडी कह रही है, डॉक्टर एक्स इज अ लीडिंग medical practitioner in a city and because of some ignorance, actually deliberately he is not doing this, because some ignorance he could not follow the taxation rules, income tax rules or other taxation rules. So there are some technical deformities in his income tax statement. And you are an income tax officer, so how will you perform here? This is the case study. कैसे आप perform करोगे यहाँ पर? तो यहाँ पे दो option दिए हैं, taking a broader view, ensure substantial tax compliance and ignore defaults that are technical in nature. Second, pursue the matter strictly and proceed on all fronts, whether substantial or merely technical. तो कौन सा करेंगे हम फॉलो, बताइए अब इतनी देर डिस्कशन के बाद। फर्स्ट वाला वी विल इग्नोर द टेक्निकल ग्लिचेस। हाउ विल यू कम टू नो ही इज अ गुड मैन? हाउ? You have a large number of assessees. You do not know personally any person. So you cannot make any conjecture that he is a good man. He is running a trust. Okay. So you will go through deontology. So you will try to make the technical requirements fulfilled. कैसे? इसके लिए क्या करेंगे आप? You will provide assistance, technical assistance. Yes, आप उसको technical assistance provide कीजिए, ये काम कर सकते हैं आप, ठीक है? तो यहां पर option two choose करना होगा, क्योंकि आप एक public servant हैं, ठीक है? यहां पर आप ऐसे नहीं कह सकते ये तो अच्छा आदमी है तो इसके लिए थोड़ा सा flexible कर देते हैं rules. No, you can do that. You will provide personal assistance, technical assistance. Okay. अब यहां पर इतनी सी बात में केस स्टडी खत्म नहीं हो जाएगी. केस स्टडी में यहां पे इन्वॉल्व कौन कौन से हैं मैटर्स? वही मैटर्स जो पीछे हमने देखे थे, डिओंटोलॉजी. आप डिओंटोलॉजी को यहां पर इन्वॉल्व करेंगे, ठीक है? बिकॉज मीन्स आर इंपॉर्टेंट. नेक्स्ट, इसलिए तो आप टेक्निकल असिस्टेंस दे रहे हैं. फिर उससे पूरा आपने टैक्स भरवा लिया, ठीक है? पब्लिक का पैसा है, ठीक है? तो इस तरह से आप सेकंड ऑप्शन को यहां पर लेंगे, इमोशनली इंटेलिजेंट होकर इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस का यूज करेंगे, ठीक है? अब भाई बार बार चीजें रिपीट होंगी, है ना? इस तरह से आप इसको लिख सकते हैं. And last is, Edward Snowden, a computer expert from former CIA administrator, released confidential government documents to the press about the existence of government surveillance program. According to many legal experts and the US government, his action violated the Espionage Act of 1971, which identified the leak of state secret as an act of treason. Yet, despite the fact that he broke the law, Snowden argued that he had a moral obligation to act. He gave a justification for his whistleblowing by stating that he had a duty to inform the public as to that which is done in their name and that which is done against them. According to Snowden, the government's violation of privacy had to be exposed regardless of legality, since more substantive issues of social action and public morality were involved here. Many agreed with. Few argued that he broke the law and compromised national security, for which he should be held accountable. Do you agree that Snowden's actions were ethically justified, even if legally prohibited? Why or why not? Make an argument by weighing the competing values in this case. Okay, so Snowden arguing that he is a whistleblower. Okay, so according to him, his action is whistleblowing. Is it right? क्या होता है whistleblowing? Whistleblowing क्या है? To whistle against illegal actions. So Snowden, when he came into contract. With his employer, तो जो contract में आया था, he was knowing very well what Espionage Act of 1971 says. उसे पता था 1971, so he was under contract. So as rightly pointed out by Socrates says that I am in social contract with Athens, law of Athens. because this law of Athens provide me legitimate right of Greek citizenship, Athens citizenship, hana? This law recognize my parents, it recognizes my parents, that is why I am a legitimate son. So once you are in contact with the society, you have to abide by all the rules and regulations. Otherwise you have an option, just take your all the assets, your properties and exile. To kisne mana kiya? If you want to whistle blow, you want to blow the whistle, then you have to first give your resignation properly. To isko pehle to resign karna chahiye tha, ye to isne kiya nahi, and he misused the documents, so he is actually violating the acts confidentiality. क्योंकि जब वो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट में आया था तब उसको ये ध्यान रखना था, तो सबसे पहले उसको रिजाइन करना था. सो ही डिडंट रिजाइन, इट मींस हिज एक्शन इज नॉट प्रॉपर एक्शन. ओके, तो वी विल कोट सोक्रेटिस अबाउट एंड सोशल कॉन्ट्रैक्ट थ्योरी. ड्यूटी, उसकी ड्यूटी क्या है? एक्चुअल ड्यूटी, प्राइम ऑफिस ड्यूटी है ना, उसको ये करना होगा. तो कैसे इसको बताएंगे, इसके आर्गुमेंट्स को कैसे, वाई एंड वाई नॉट में कैसे करेंगे. सेकंड थिंग, विशल ब्लोइंग क्या होती है? विशल ब्लोइंग क्या होती है? विशल ब्लोइंग इज अबाउट इलीगल एक्शंस, इज अबाउट इलीगल एक्शंस. सो एक्शंस आर लीगल, दे हैव लीगल सैंक्शंस बिकॉज गवर्नमेंट इज विलिंग टू डू एस्पियनेज, that is why they are doing, and he was employed for the sake of espionage, and he is saying that this is wrong. So this is wrong, to bhai chhod do na job, chhodo aap. Okay, hamare yahan bhi civil services conduct rules mein kehte hain ki if you are not considering that government is functioning well and you have any conflict with the decisions of the government, then first of all you must resign, pehle resign kar dena chahiye, then you take any decision. ठीक है, तो यहां पर why and why nots को इस तरह से आप explain कर सकते हैं. अब काफी समय हो गया है, मैं भी थक गया हूं. ठीक है.